Hey, welcome back to Jet City. It's time for your questions 23. Why am I wearing a heavy coat and a toque? It's not a beanie, it's a toque. Why am I wearing this? It's cold outside and it's frosty and snowy. Last week it was minus 35. Now it's only about 5 degrees below freezing, so no big deal. Nice and frosty. Still, I'd rather be inside making a video. All right, first question is, thank you for your videos and thank you for the knowledge. Is there any provision to keep the LP spool bearings lubricated when the engine is shut down but the fan is freewheeling in the wind? This must be about aircraft in an airport that are parked and their turbofan engines, the fans are, sometimes they move in the wind, which we call windmilling. I was watching a CFM56 fan spinning while my flight was parked at the gate the other day. CFM56s are in Airbuses, A340s, A320s, planes like that, and 737s. Okay, the engine was definitely shut down. And the strong winds were turning the fan. I assume the oil pump would be driven by the HP spool to ensure immediate oil pressure for startup. Is that correct? Maybe there's just enough residual oil in the bearings that it isn't an issue. And this is by Sid Kling. And Sid Kling, you are exactly right. Let's see where you're right. You are right that I assume the oil pump would be driven by the HP spool. It is. And that's because the HP spool is basically the core of the engine. It burns the fuel, and the HP system, as I've said before, would run without the LP system, only less efficiently. Let's actually draw a picture of that. We've got our handy US Air Force surplus demonstration kit consisting of a start cart and a whiteboard. So let's draw a picture. Okay, this is gonna be fast and freehand. Let's see, we have the, well, let's draw the LP system first. There's the fan, the shaft, and then the LP turbine, which is usually more than one stage. Okay, I'll use another color. For the HP system, you've got a, sometimes it's a single stage turbine. Hollow shaft, and you've got the HP compressor, which something like that. Shorten that one a bit. Okay, it's going to look like that on both sides. There we go, something like that. And the fuel gets burnt there. So your air comes in here. Let's draw the, we don't have a, let's see, let's use a blue. The engine core is something like this. Something like that. Okay. So your bypass air comes through the fan and bypasses the engine. Goes around the engine. That's why it's called bypass air. It bypasses the HP compressor, the combustors, and the turbines. It contributes most of the thrust. Now this thing can turn because there are bearings and there's nothing attached to the low pressure system. Let's see, LP. All of the machinery, HP, the way the engine's built, we've gone over this before, there will be, I have yellow here, is the yellow working? Yellow is working. There will be somewhere, in some engines it's right up front, some engines it's in the middle, but there will be a radial drive shaft. There'll be a gearbox on a gear running a drive shaft down to a bunch of accessories. And those accessories are the oil pump, the fuel pumps, generators, this, that, what have you. Anything that needs mechanical power is driven off the HP system. Because the starter cranks the HP compresses the air, burns the air, goes through the turbine. This turbine powers the HP compressor. So you can see how it can run just fine without any help from the LP. The leftover exhaust from the HP goes through the LP turbine, turns this long blue shaft that goes right down the middle and is attached to nothing except for the fan. Now the fan helps a little bit pushing air in there, but if we remove the entire blue system here, the engine would run. Okay, there's our picture. Okay, there's our picture, and it's warming up here in the test cell. So, the reason the fan turns in the wind is there's nothing stopping it from turning. It's got some really nice bearings, and there's no gear connecting it to any sort of driven accessory. There's no drag, there's nothing on the turbine or the fan that's gonna stop it from moving. As a matter of fact, you could go up to a parked 747 or A380, and that big 12-foot fan, you could move it with your little finger. You could. I've done it. Okay, so that's why it's turning. And you're also right. You're also right in saying that there is enough residual oil in those bearings to protect them from any mechanical load that's going to be from just having the thing turn over at 1 or 2 RPM, or even 10 RPM. It's no big deal. The oil is enough. You're not going to build up any heat by it turning like this. Now, if it's spinning at 100 RPM in a very strong wind for an hour, that's not a big deal. If it's all day, not that much of a big deal. But if it's going to be weeks on end, you need to either stop it from turning or supply oil to it. So usually airliners aren't parked for weeks on end. And if they are, there's going to be a cover in the front of the engine and the back of the engine to prevent air from going through there and from dirt from getting in. But basically, the bearing is under so much load when it's in service and it's designed for such incredibly high loading that when it's sitting there freewheeling in the wind, that percentage of its load is essentially nothing. So that's a very good question by Sid Kling. And I have answered this before with a whiteboard drawing, but it's a popular question. So here it is again in questions 23. Good question. Okay, question number two is an interesting one. Can you generally speak as to what the tolerance stack is from the end of all components on an engine? An airframe can differ from its brethren by several inches, and I'm curious how that compares to its engines. I work in a machine shop that's beginning to see a lot of work related to structural components of turbofans, and it's not uncommon to see diametric and runout clearances in the fourth decimal place in imperial units. Could you approximate the total axial runout of an engine from front to back? Okay, now this is by a guy that we've heard from before with one of the most disgusting names ever, Crazy Bum Fungus. Good one, yeah. Anyway, I've drawn another picture with my incredibly bad art skills, and we're gonna zoom in on that, and I'm gonna talk about tolerance stacks of the whole engine. Hang on. Okay, this is a very bad rendition of a simple single shaft turbojet. We've got the compressor, the turbines, the shaft, and the blue part is the outer casing of the engine. Now these things are not walls. They are struts, and we've talked about struts before, so hope you're up on that. It was a video, just a couple videos ago, that I went through a great deal of explanation about struts. Okay, here's the rear bearing housing, the rear frame, and the rear bearing's right there. You've got a roller bearing. And the front bearing housing is held by the front struts, and there's a roller bearing there. Here is the center casing, or the midframe, and there is a ball bearing And a ball bearing means you can push on it either way and it won't move in its tracks. It fixes the location of this shaft. This green thing is all one piece. It's bolted together by a coupling. Oh, let's see. We got a coupling that's roughly about there. Okay? So, this bearing allows movement by up to about a quarter of an inch from heat expansion from this. This bearing allows movement about a quarter of an inch. The races, those bearings look like this. The race will be that wide and the rollers will be this wide all the way around. So there's this much room to move. A lot of room. Let's get rid of that. So this shaft, it's very cold here and it's very hot here. This can expand and contract. So there's a lot of room for movement here. There's a lot of room for movement there. A lot of room. And also the engine itself will expand and contract depending on temperature. This center frame and the shaft and the thrust bearing are fixed in place. That's the only place in the whole engine where movement is not possible. So for the overall length of the engine, for the overall length of the engine, it doesn't matter. So we don't even know what it's supposed to be. There is no specified measurement of the length of the shaft. There isn't. This shaft is stuck into the back of this shaft and it's bolted together. There's no overall length measurement for the engine. There is no length measurement for the engine. And if you were to measure the length of the engine, you'd have to have a giant set of calipers that would reach down like that and they'd be 15 feet long. It doesn't matter. There's a lot of room for movement. So the answer to your question, crazy bum fungus, is there is no stack tolerance anywhere except in the thrust bearing. Because in the thrust bearing, you've got one race like this. One race is like that. The other race is like this. Right, like that. And you've got the balls are in there. Let's draw one that's installed incorrectly. Nice round ball. Isn't that nice and round? Yes, I'm a very good artist. But this space in here, that space, it shouldn't be there. So this is incorrectly installed. What you want to do is you want to measure this dimension here. You want to measure this dimension here. And then you want to make sure that when it's installed, that this dimension equals those two, plus or minus less than 1/1000th of an inch. That's all I can tell you about stack tolerances. They're important for the thrust bearing race when it's installed. As for the length of the engine, it's not mentioned. Never mind not measured, it's not even mentioned in the overhaul manual. For an aircraft designer, there would be a nominal length of the engine to the nearest inch or so. There is no overall length of the engine. Doesn't matter. Okay, since we're talking about bearings, the very next question is from 88 Goldwinger. And he asks, just watching your video on questions number 9, I thought I would ask you to further explain a little bit more about how the bearings support the turbine and compressor shaft. Could you explain the difference between ball bearings and roller bearings? Yes, but I already have. You want to watch a video of mine called Twin Shaft Turbine Engine Bearings. I show where they are and what they look like, and I demonstrate how a thrust bearing is different from a roller bearing. And rather than do it all over again, watch that video. You'll like it. Thanks. Okay, question number 4 is, what actually is EGT telling you besides exhaust gas temperature? Well, EGT stands for exhaust gas temperature. So EGT is telling us that. But there's a reason we measure it. Hang on. The reason we measure exhaust gas temperature is we want to make sure those exhaust gases, it's not really, I guess, exhaust, it's exhaust from the combustion chamber, the combustors. Okay, you want the gas flowing through the turbine to be as hot as possible, to contain as much energy as possible, but not too hot, so you burn and damage the turbine. So this particular engine is a very good example to help me explain what we're doing. These are thermocouples that measure the temperature of the combustion gases before they go through the turbines. So these are measuring exactly what the turbines are gonna get, and it's hot. So in early models, these would burn out all the time and have to be replaced very often. There was a modification made to the engine. The thermocouples were moved from before the turbine to after the turbine, and that's what these are. Why are they both on this engine? Because we're an engine shop. We have pieces lying around everywhere, and we made an engine out of whatever we had laying around. So we had the combustion case from an early model that has the thermocouples here, and we had an exhaust duct from an engine that was of the later model with the thermocouples here. So we got both. We only have one set hooked up. We could measure it in either place. It's gonna be hotter here than it is there. But the reason we measure exhaust gas temperature here, it's to indicate what's going through the turbines. So it's gonna be colder here than it is here. And so the thermocouple is gonna last longer. It's not gonna burn out. But we have to, there's a calculation because it's actually colder here than it is here. And this is where it's gonna do the damage to the turbines if it's too hot. Here, these measure directly what's going into the turbine, and they don't last as long. Now, what is the actual temperature that each engine, it's the critical upper limit? It's different with each engine, because the exhaust gas temperature is measured at a different location, and the turbines are made of different alloys. Sometimes an updated engine will have a higher EGT limit because the metal blades of the turbine are of a better alloy or a more advanced alloy, or also the turbine blades could be air cooled. There's internal passages that air is blasted through to cool them, so they can tolerate a higher exhaust gas or combustion gas going through them. So that was a very good question by Wojtek Horsky. I think that's how I say your name. Not exactly sure. Wojtek Horsky. A very good question, very technical question. You must really know what you're talking about, unlike me. Okay, and the fifth question is by Kowalski Elba. And it is, some turbines like GE Frame 5 have the first turbine stage impulse and the second stage is reaction. Based on the video, having all the turbine stages as reaction type, is this right? What are the pros and cons of having impulse and reaction turbine blades? A very complicated question that we're gonna have to draw another picture for. Hang on. Okay, this is another very highly technical and artistic drawing by me. Very quickly, there are two types of turbines, and there's a very subtle difference. The impulse turbine, it changes the direction of a certain flow of gas at a certain speed. And so it's like the air hits it and deflects the turbine this way. There's no change in speed of the gases going through the turbine. So we're gonna put a number here. We're just gonna say 100. Let's say that's 100 miles per hour. And the gas enters at 100 miles an hour and leaves at 100 miles per hour. The impulse gets its momentum, produces its torque, by the changing of direction of a high speed flow of gases. Reaction turbine also does that a little bit, but it also, this distance and that distance, and here it's the same distance. From the entrance and the exit, it's the same distance. It changes the direction of the air, and so it causes it to push the blades this way. The reaction, it's a larger opening in the entrance than it is on the exit, so the gas might enter at 100 miles per hour, and it'll leave at 100 and, let's just say, 150. So it speeds up. That causes a thrust on the blades. So the reaction type turbine does both. And that is an oversimplification of the differences. because most turbine blades, almost all turbines, are a combination of the two. They're called impulse reaction turbines. They look almost exactly the same. The differences are in the subtle changes in shape and spacing of the turbine blades and turbine nozzles. All I can tell you is they're most likely a combination of impulse reaction. It doesn't tell us in the overhaul manual whether it's an impulse turbine or a reaction turbine, because we don't need to know that. We need to know if it's damaged or if it's in good condition. So I don't know what kind it is. And what are the pros and cons? I'm sure there are different characteristics and different efficiencies for each one. The impulse turbine is used for water most commonly. It's a water turbine. The reaction turbine must have its disadvantages because most aerodynamic turbines are a combination of the two. It's all in the math and the curvature and stuff that is really beyond me to explain, so I'm not going to. Thank you for your question, Kowalski. And once again from the test cell, thanks for watching.